Final Fantasy IX. We finally come to the end of our PlayStation 1 era of Final Fantasy games. If you ask me, this is the center of the golden age of Final Fantasy. After exploring more modern themes with 7 and 8, Final Fantasy IX takes us right back to medieval-like classical fantasy. That's represented in the game's logo, a golden crystal that lets us know we're going back to the roots of Final Fantasy. Crystals are often at the core of a Final Fantasy story, but less and less so over time. Crystals were only subtle references in the stories of the last two games. FF9 for a lot of players is the greatest Final Fantasy, but it's easy to understand why. The world of Gaia is just oozing with charm and awesome characters. I know a few players who started Final Fantasy with Number 9. I had one friend who just couldn't get into Final Fantasy. That is until they saw Number 9 in action, and after exploring Alexandria and playing a bit of its in-game card game Tetra Master, they ended up getting the game and loving it. Without a shadow of a doubt, Final Fantasy IX's biggest strength is its characters. That's main characters and side characters. Throughout this journey, you're accompanied by just these amazing and lovable and sometimes relatable characters. And at no point are these characters forgotten about. They're always doing their own thing, and they each have their own virtues and dilemmas, their own journeys of self-discovery or identity. Getting to the opening for now, 9 doesn't start with reactors being bombed or death battles. It's a much more somber beginning, starting in the kingdom of Alexandria with unhappy princesses, a theater ship full of thieves, and a humble black mage wandering the streets. If you don't already recognize this iconic black mage, this is Vivi, and this guy's my favorite character, and he's a top tier Final Fantasy character. Stick around and by the end I'll share why. Back to the streets, Alexandria is just so atmospheric and chill. You get to start exploring Alexandria straight away with Vivi. One of my favourite things to do in RPGs is just going around robbing people's homes of all their treasure and life savings. This grandma doesn't really need this. We're introduced to some optional minigames really early, the Terra Master card game I'll cover in more detail later on, and jump rope skipping, where you need to consecutively jump at a faster and faster pace for some cool rewards, but it can get very frustrating very quickly with a simple slip up. What makes beginning in Alexandria so great is that you can spend literally hours here just exploring and doing minigames. During the theatre play, I Want to Be Your Canary, the airship of thieves I mentioned earlier, they end up kidnapping a princess that turns out wants to be kidnapped in a kingdom corrupted, which leads into a much larger overarching story. And the crap hits the fan with everyone's fates getting connected together, and we end up crash landing into the nearby Evil Forest. Which is just a very creative name for a forest, the Evil Forest. We're back to four-person parties and combat, and limit breaks return too. This time they're called trances. They're described as a surge of emotion, where taking damage fills your trance bar. Once full, your character will automatically power up and transform for a few turns. Trances are pretty cool. But problem is, you can't control when you activate the trance, so you get a lot of moments in combat where a character goes into trance at the very end of a battle, and it's just completely wasted. But the one saving grace of trances is when a character is in a really emotional story situation, they'll automatically trigger their trance. This is a really cool way of connecting storytelling with gameplay, letting you share a bit of empathy and feel a little bit of the character's pain by controlling them in their trance form in combat. There's already some beautiful narrative moments, only enhanced by the use of this little trance trick. So yeah, Final Fantasy IX is so charming and magical, but this same world isn't afraid to contrast this and get really dark, brutal, and hopeless. Again, it's the characters on this journey that really make this a special experience. Everyone is on their own journey, trying to find their own meaning and purpose to their lives, and everyone goes about it differently. The game's opening was made from picking out dialogue lines, and each character code gives you deep insight to the types of characters these are, as well as insight into their suffering and the journey they're on as an individual. Each of your characters takes on the spirit of a classic Final Fantasy job. From thief to summoner, everyone has their flaws and agendas, and we get to see them develop over the course of the game. Our main character, Zidane, is a thief and a bit of a girl chaser, but good at heart. Zidane's a pretty great protagonist, all about supporting people and helping bring out their best, but he'll face his own challenges before the end. Vivi is an anxious and shy black mage that challenges his own existence. Vivi has to level up his confidence to face a journey of self-discovery and identity. Garnet is a white mage summoner and princess who must go against her own mother and face the consequences. Steiner's a knight in service to Princess Garnet. He's really stubborn and blindly loyal to the Queen, but he has to discover for himself what is truly right and wrong. Freya is a dragoon who's lost her lover, and on reacquaintance, she's just been completely forgotten. A fate she considers to be worse than death, and a burden she must carry on with. Eco's another summoner. She's been abandoned by humanity and lives with Moogles. She's a bit out of touch and lonely, but she gets the opportunity to change that. Amaranth is a monk and mercenary. He's arrogant, but ends up following Zidane, simply because he can't understand why he's so successful, and how things like teamwork work. Quinna is a blue mage and chef that can use blue magic learned from eating and cooking enemies. They've got an obsession with experiencing new food, and that's what they're all about. And while characters like Quinna might seem more like comedic relief, they're still supporting characters and integral to the story of FF9. None of these characters are forgotten about throughout the course of this game. A new feature that helps with character development is the ATE system. That's active time events. We'll often get little prompts to cut away from whatever we're doing to experience little skits and see what's going on with other characters, from Quinna exploring different types of food to Steiner finding the love of his life. Active time events are a nifty little optional system that really enhances the narrative and gives you extra little character development moments. It's a pity active time events never returned in future Final Fantasy games, because it really helps with character building and it does have its magic moments. There's more side or guest characters that are pretty awesome too. But Christ, there are so many thieves in this game, and in Final Fantasy, their signature ability is Steal, which allows you to steal items from enemies. And in FF9, every boss has pretty awesome equipment to steal, and while that is really cool, stealing items isn't a 100% chance guarantee. So I'll end up pausing the actual combat with a boss and sit there for ages stealing over and over again to get all the rare equipment. You can get things that help improve the chance of stealing, and you don't have to steal, but bosses usually carry pretty powerful equipment, and I just feel like I'm missing out if I don't steal them. I always feel bad for Blank. He's one of our thieves that goes out of his way to help us and gets petrified on our escape through the evil forest. I reckon he could have been a pretty chill main party character, if not for his unfortunate fate early on. He's the kind of guy that would always have your back. Speaking of that evil forest, after our crash landing, Zidane leads a crew in a mission to rescue our kidnapped princess, who's now gone missing. After we escape from the forest and lose Blank, we reach Final Fantasy IX's overworld. The overworld is gorgeous. It's a bit misty at the moment, but that gets cleared up later on. This is the last mainline Final Fantasy to feature an overworld map, and it's probably the best one. The music in the overworld is incredible. It's just so calm and relaxing crossing those hills. I wish we still got proper overworlds in future Final Fantasy games. There's just something about them that gives the world a sense of scale. There's elements of exploration, discovery, and progression when you gain access to things like chocobos and vehicles that allow you to access new locations or heights. Overworlds are awesome. Princess Garnet's goal is to reach out to her uncle Cid in Lindblum regarding issues with her mother, the Queen. In an attempt to conceal her identity, Garnet has the brilliant idea to rename herself to Dagger after examining Zidane's daggers. Dagger. I can't stand this name. Who renames themselves Dagger? Maybe the rest of the party can be called Sword and Staff. Garnet sticks with her new name for the rest of the game. Maybe it sounds a lot cooler in Japanese, but I always just opt to rename her back to Garnet. Basically, three big bad black mages, Black Waltzers, have been sent by the Queen to retrieve our kidnapped Princess Garnet. While we easily deal with the first two waltzers, the third is pretty tough. And there's just this incredible cinematic, one of my favourite moments in the game. Vivi is trying to find out about his own existence by speaking with these black mages, but they don't really respond and they just ignore him. Until the Black Waltz appears. The black mages then try to protect Vivi, and it just feels terrible as they're all slaughtered all around him. Ah, it still hits me in the feels even today. But it is so satisfying seeing Vivi finally snap, blasting the Black Waltz out of the sky. this is only the start of our party's journey. There's still quite a road ahead for each of our characters. And for some, this is going to be a journey surrounded by death. Speaking of characters, FF9 has a decent character customization system, and that's the support ability system. It's basically just a point-based system. So, all equipment contains abilities that you can learn by simply having the weapon or armor equipped and defeating enemies. Each character has a set number of ability points determined by their level, and you can activate all the support abilities you've learned at the cost of your ability points. It's a very simple point-based system, not too complicated, and you can customize your characters and come up with some decent builds. It doesn't get as in-depth as the Materia system or Aids Junction system, but it does the job. Every character in FF9 has a preset classical Final Fantasy job at their core, so you can't change them too much, but there's enough room for a little experimentation. It's really satisfying mid to end game when you can make your characters automatically regenerate or permanently speed them up with auto haste. If you're struggling with a boss, you could reassign your support abilities to exploit its weakness, or alternatively build up your defenses to what elements or status effects the boss performs. It is decent, but the one big disadvantage to this system is that I'm often holding back from using my strongest weapons or equipment, and that's because I'm equipping lower level equipment till I've learnt all of its abilities, so I usually force myself to do a bit of extra grinding to keep up to date with equipment, which can be a bit lame. Things get really dark when you arrive at Bermacia, and you start to understand why Princess Garnet is against her Queen Mother, who's been waging war with the innocent. Again, it's the contrast from the cute fantasy visuals to this hellscape of death and darkness that makes this story and world of Gaia so compelling. This is where the antagonist of FF9 is first introduced, Kuja. This guy is the Queen's weapon dealer who's been supplying her with armies of black mages, slaves to wage war. At first glance, he does look absolutely ridiculous in his thong, but after our defeat at the hands of the Queen, he just smugly looms over our defeated party in the rain before flying off. Now this is how you introduce an antagonist. Kuja is a horrible person who brings about plenty of death. But behind all that, he's still written as someone with some humanity. We get to see his insecurities and regrets, and while this monster doesn't deserve redemption, he does get the opportunity to repent and do a little good in his final moments. You can say Kuja is a lame villain, but did 7 Sephiroth or 8 Ultimicia ever look back? They just became monsters fixated on death and destruction. That's why I like Kuja. He's just got that extra dimension to him, that tiny little side of him who comes out before it's all over. No matter how dark things get, there's always time for minigames. Throughout Final Fantasy IX, there's all these little minigames. Jump ropes, swordplay, frog catching, there's even a hidden blackjack minigame in the credits. As well as just little moments in the story that present themselves as little minigames. They all serve to keep gameplay feeling fresh. But the big minigame I want to focus on is Tetra Master. It's a new card game, and at literally any point in the game you can challenge people to a game by just pressing the square button. Forget our antagonist Kuja, let's play some Tetra Master. Spooky ghosts, let's play Tetra Master. End of the world approaching, still time for Tetra Master. Cards battle each other with different directional arrows and values, on a 4x4 grid. It is pretty fun collecting all the cards, albeit the values and strengths on cards can be really complicated to understand and learn. Here's a quick tutorial, the first two values are used for attacks, and the last two are used for defense. The first, third, and fourth values represent a value from 0 to 9, and then A to F. The first represents the power of a card, second represents a card's class, P for physical, M for magical, X for flexible, or A for assault, while the third value represents the physical defense, and the fourth represents magical defense. Feeling lost yet? It is pretty crazy, it's pretty complicated for what it is. I never 100% fully grasped all the rules, but I was still able to have fun with Tetra Master. Here comes the inevitable comparison with Final Fantasy VIII's card game, Triple Triad, because these are currently the only two mainline single-player Final Fantasy games with a card game. In number 8, you can transform your Triple Triad cards into useful items, crafting materials, or magic. Effectively, Triple Triad could be used as an alternative progression method to powering up your characters. Nang's Tetra Master doesn't have any of that. It's just a collectible card game. I feel like card values are a lot easier to understand in number 8 too, at least until the rules get crazy. If I had to choose between the two card games, I think I'd go with number 8's Triple Triad. I just love how integral to the game's progression systems it can be, and extra points for it being the original. Putting the cards down for now, something really iconic with Final Fantasy are summons, powerful magic creatures that can be called in battle. Summons return to being an integral part of the story. Our villain Kuja, that's the smug weapon dealer from earlier, he gives our power-hungry queen access to summoning magic, which is only used to further fuel the flames of war. We get to see these pretty incredible cinematics of the summons, Atomos, Odin, Bahamut. They're just incredible for a PlayStation 1 game. I know I've said this over and over throughout this era of Final Fantasy games, but the cinematics are so good, and they just keep getting better. They're even more awe-dropping with the more classical fantasy setting and over-the-top magical elements. But yeah, this new summoning magic ends up being the downfall of the power-crazed queen, who even turns on her own weapon dealer. But turns out Kuja has the ability to capture and control summons. And he's collecting summons like Ash Ketchup collects Pokemon.
Who's that Pokemon? It's...
The Queen's summon is used against her, and there's just this one really grim scene I'll never forget, where we find the Queen just dying on the beach. Our Princess Garnet gets to hear the Queen's final words and regrets. Again and again, I can't stress it enough. You just don't expect this colourful, chirpy fantasy world to have these brutal, dark edges to it. I do really like that summons are a major part of the story again, just like classic Final Fantasy games. We've got all the classics like Ramu, Ifrit, Shiva, but there's also a few extra summons to earn, including Ark. You'll need to synthesize really rare materials together, or defeat an optional endgame super boss to get access to this one. This is the first time Ark has appeared in a Final Fantasy, and it's a bit weird. It's an airship that travels between planets, it transforms into a mech robot, and obliterates everything on screen in a typical over-the-top Final Fantasy fashion. Because Ark has to fly in from the moon, it comes in as the second longest summoning animation in all of Final Fantasy. Well, player-controlled summon, that is. But the reward is worth the effort, even if it is just to witness this over-the-top summoning animation. A completely new arc in the story begins as we return to where Final Fantasy IX all began, Alexandria. We're even back to playing in Vivi's shoes. This time our Princess Garnet has inherited the throne of Alexandria. But it's not long till Kuja comes for Alexandria, unleashing monsters and its latest summon Bahamut on the city. I always remember this little epic Steiner moment as he assembles his knights and defends the streets. We then get one of the most iconic moments of the game, when Garnet and Ico unlock the secrets of the city of Alexandria. It's the summon Alexander itself, and it's used to stop Bahamut in more jaw-dropping cinematics. After recovering from our last battle, we end up giving chase to our antagonist Kuja, who flees to a new continent. We very quickly fall into a trap and are captured. It's at this part of the game I royally messed up. I was much younger when I played Final Fantasy IX for the first time. I had done a few RPGs, so I was getting much better at them, but I still managed to make a critical error here. Basically, Kuja wants you to retrieve an artifact in exchange for everyone's freedom. But it's at an anti-magic location where magic can't be used, so he can't get the artifact himself. You're allowed to take a party of four in this mission, but you must use your four party members. This is where I really messed up. I admit I wasn't paying attention and I took a party full of magic users to an anti-magic place. And I had such a hard time I ended up giving up, taking a break, and replaying the game from scratch later on. During the mission we start to discover hints of another world, Terra. This is where Kuja intends to travel with his own plans. But to unlock access to the world of Terra, we need to travel to four different elemental shrines and defeat their guardians. This is actually a direct callback to the original Final Fantasy's four fiends, who you fight at each of the four shrines. The guardians are even the same monsters as the original four fiends. You eventually break through to the other world of Terra, and this is where the story gets really weird. We get this kind of ridiculous information dump really late into the story, and it gets really confusing at least first time through. So, turns out, apparently the planet of Terra tried to fuse with our planet, but it all went wrong. So Terra ended up shifting into the inside of our planet instead. And Terra has been leeching the souls of the dead of our planet.
What?
Terra's leader, Garland, sends Kuja to our planet to incite war, and so Terra could suck up more souls.
What?
We find out through Garland that our main characters Zidane and antagonist Kuja are both from the race of Geonomes and from the planet Terra. And Zidane would one day succeed Kuja as an angel of death.
What?
Yeah, it goes off the deep end pretty quick. Zidane kind of just has a breakdown. Zidane goes from being the always chirpy, overconfident hero to just broken and depressed. He slogs after Garland all alone. The guy who's all about helping people just gives up on everyone and himself. It's in this moment my favourite music piece for Final Fantasy IX plays, You're Not Alone. It's like a blend of light and dark music, with somber soft tones to match Zidane's depression. But then the guitar kicks in with a little rock, as one by one the crew of Final Fantasy IX jump in to support Zidane. Like Final Fantasy VII, personal identity is one of the core themes of Number 9. Zidane's having his own identity issue, and it's hard not to feel empathetic, especially with musical moments like this. Zidane was all about supporting everyone and helping everyone realize their true identity, or best selves. Now, everyone comes together to help Zidane realize his. Everyone slowly comes to his aid. He's saved and breaks out of his existential crisis. I want to take a moment to appreciate the music in this game. You're Not Alone is my favourite piece, but I think my second favourite piece would have to be Crossing Those Hills. That's the overworld theme I mentioned earlier. The world of FF9 is just so charming, and this might just be my most favourite overworld theme of all Final Fantasy games. It's just so calm and relaxing. It trickles in with almost little music bubbles and echoes of nostalgia. When I listen to this, I can just imagine the overworld's grasslands with some mountainsides nearby, and I can almost hear the Moogle whistle being blown to get Moguo to save the game. I think my third favourite piece would have to be Living by the Sword. This is the battle music that plays when you're taking part in the theatre play near the start of the game. Once it really kicks in, it's just a really upbeat and pleasant battle theme, with elements of magical fantasy tones. I feel like this piece is criminally underused. But then again, if it was reused as much as the general battle theme, it would lose a bit of its magic. I would also give the general battle theme an honourable mention. But like I said, it just loses a bit of its magic when it's repeated so much. It's not tied to any specific moments in the game, which makes it a little bit less unique and special. And as we're approaching Endgame, it's finally time to talk about my favourite side activity, Chocobo digging. It's a pretty in-depth system where you dig for treasure, hot and cold style. Your Chocobo levels up and eventually changes colours and gains new abilities, letting you access new areas on the world map. Pretty cool, right? There's actually some upgrades and progression-based rewards, which were sorely missing from the Tetra Master card game. You'll occasionally dig up Choco Graphs, which are just slates with pictures of locations on, and if you find and go to those locations on the world map, you can dig up some pretty awesome rewards. Upgrading your Chocobo with new colours is pretty sweet, and eventually you'll unlock access to new digging areas, including the Chocobo Paradise and Air Garden. But here's the thing, at the very back of the garden lies an optional super boss. Ozma. There's not much context to Ozma. We're not really sure what it is. It takes on the appearance of a giant marble with light and dark sides, and is described as not from this world. There's theories it's a powerful mythical summon, but not much is known about Ozma. I never initially beat Ozma until later playthroughs. Ozma hits the party with extremely powerful Holy and Shadow damage, and regularly heals itself. For a Final Fantasy Super boss, I didn't actually find him too challenging. I just swapped in a few pieces of equipment that were strong against Holy and Shadow damage, swapped a few support abilities, and just pumped out as much damage as possible before Ozma would completely destroy the party. It took a few tries, but I got it done. There's Hades, which can be considered a super boss too. Not quite as difficult as Ozma, but I like that Hades will even acknowledge if you've already defeated Ozma before facing him. So the Final Fantasy series started evolving into more modern settings. But from the start, FF9 was designed to be a classic callback and love letter to the series. A big focus on summons, classic Final Fantasy jobs, callbacks to the shrines and four fiends. And as I mentioned, the idea of the crystal on the game's front cover was supposed to represent all of this back to the roots of Final Fantasy philosophy. Thing is, the actual big crystal of Final Fantasy IX is not seen or heard of until the very end of the game. It's a little disappointing this crystal didn't come into the story a bit earlier. Alright, time to get a little story heavy for the moment. I want to talk about Final Fantasy IX's ending. After Garland's defeat, Kuja discovers that he has a limited lifespan, and Zidane was designed to be his replacement. Kuja's insecurities come out front and center, and he goes berserk, using the souls he's collected from Gaia to power himself up into his own transform. With his death on the horizon, he plans to take the universe with him by destroying the crystal, which is apparently the life force of the entire universe. There is a pretty epic final battle with Kuja, and you can see that crystal from the game's logo in the background. Love his theme, Dark Messenger. Dark Messenger to me meant as in the Angel of Death who brings souls to Terra. They pull out the good old pipe organ for this one. The music starts off like his original theme with a build-up of terrifying drum beats. Which then transitions into crazy mode with funky guitar riffs. Kinda matches Kuja's crazy current state of mind with wanting to destroy everything. What comes next is probably the most controversial part of all of Final Fantasy IX. Necron. This guy just comes out of nowhere. He also wants to destroy the crystal and bring about darkness. Necron pushes Kuja aside to take the role of the true final boss. Who is this guy? And he's even stealing dialogue from Star Wars. After the battle for the universe, we're all teleported out to safety. I mentioned this earlier, but Kuja's on his deathbed and he comes to his senses. He has a mini redemption moment where he teleports everyone out to safety. Speaking of Star Wars, I guess this is a bit of a Darth Vader moment. He can't be forgiven for everything he's done, inciting all the war and death, but he can still make this one last act of good and have a little bit of redemption. Zidane, just being who he is, risks everything to speak with Kuja in his final moments. That is, till everything collapses all around them and it's over. While everyone else escapes, the credits roll, and we get to see the epilogues and endings to everyone's journeys. And honestly, I just didn't want the epilogue to end. I don't want to leave these characters in this world behind, but all good things must come to an end. I want to try something new. Before I get into fully analysing the ending, I want to share what my favourite moments of Final Fantasy IX were, and in a top 5 format, here goes. Number 5. Kuja's introduction. This is how you introduce a villain, just his smug-ass face looming over your completely defeated party in the rain. Again, the music really intensifies the moment, with the overpowering build-up of beats against the sound of the rain. This moment really sells you on the main antagonist, and gives you an impression of just how much stronger he is. A really dramatic way to end the game's first disc. Number 4. Bahamut and Alexander duking it out over the city of Alexandria has got to be one of the most visually impressive cinematics on the PlayStation 1, period. I just love Final Fantasy summons becoming a critical part of the story again. It's all out battle stations, and I love playing Steiner and Beatrix cleaning up the streets of monsters to some pretty damn epic music. Number 3. The You're Not Alone moment. It just hit me really hard and made me like Zidane more as a character. He spends most of the game helping people, always chirpy, and he just has this existential crisis. His very identity and existence crumbles around him. The You're Not Alone music really helps sell this moment, as everyone he's helped comes to save him and return the favour. Number 2. Black Waltz number 3. There's this really heartbreaking moment with Vivi. He's trying to communicate with other Black Mages to learn about his existence. That is until the Black Waltz appears to kill the party and retrieve the princess. The Black Mages go against their orders to try and protect Vivi. It's just heartbreaking experiencing the Black Waltz's brutality as he murders his own kind. And then you contrast that with Vivi's own sadness. Probably the most tragic and horrifying scene in the whole game as all the Black Mages are murdered. But at least it's so satisfying seeing Vivi finally snap and give the Black Waltz what it deserves in a climactic airship chase. Number 1. The real ending. I love the ending of Final Fantasy IX. After Kuja and Zazine are finished off, we get a theatre play similar to how the game started, I Want to Be Your Canary Again. But this time Marcus is played by a different actor. It's a happy ending with Zidane announcing his love for Garnet in a Disney-esque moment, as Garnet throws everything aside to reunite with Zidane. Well, you think it's a happy ending, until you realize the game's monologue is actually spoken by Vivi. His life has expired, and this is him saying goodbye to his friends. Farewell, my memories will be a part of the sky. He never got the chance to thank or say goodbye to Zidane. Hell, he didn't even know Zidane was still alive. Final Fantasy IX's ending hits really hard in the feelings. It's a mix of happiness and sadness between Zidane and Vivi's fate. Vivi, like the other Black Mages, was created for war by Kuja, and he has a limited lifespan. Vivi learns of his fate through the other Black Mages at their hidden village. The Black Mages slowly, one by one, stop functioning. The innocent Black Mages aren't familiar with the concept of death, and can only describe it in their own words. Vivi ends up saving the universe and facing death itself, as in Necron. This is all while his own mortality looms over him, knowing he's going to die soon. He might not even make it all the way on his journey. Contrasting Vivi with our antagonist Kuja, it turns out Kuja also has a very limited lifespan, and when this is revealed to him, he throws a tantrum and tries to take everyone with him by destroying the universe itself. It just shows how awesome of a person Vivi is. He's a realistic person written by realistic people. He's gentle, big-hearted, gullible, shy. He has anxieties and uncertainty. He's a believable character, and he comes out on top, with a little help from Zidane, who helps build up Vivi's confidence and acts like his brother. Vivi's own mortality and death is just kind of heartbreaking. Little plot twist of my own. In my title, I Don't Want You to End, you might have thought I was referring to Final Fantasy IX itself, as in I don't want Final Fantasy IX to end. But truthfully, it's Vivi I was referring to. I don't want Vivi to end. Vivi is one of the greatest Final Fantasy characters ever written. For a Final Fantasy death that happens off screen, it hits really hard. But once Vivi learnt of his fate, he was all about the journey. And check this, the word Vivi itself roughly translates to I lived in multiple languages. Man, looking back at the Black Mage Village, this might just be one of the most saddest and tragic locations in all of Final Fantasy. Despite death looming above all the Black Mages with their very limited lifespan, there's a little life symbolized in this village too. Two Black Mages make it their mission to protect and raise an abandoned Chocobo egg. The Chocobo eventually hatches, and he's named Bobby Corwen. Bobby Corwen. What a weird name. I always thought Bobby Corwen might be a reference to someone in real life. But no, it turns out if you smash those two names together, you get Boko, a reoccurring name of a special Chocobo throughout Final Fantasy. It's just another really heartfelt moment considering all the tragedy and death surrounding these Black Mages. Some other quick mentions. I think Blank is a really awesome side character. It's really unfortunate that he gets petrified early on and is unable to go on the adventure that is Final Fantasy IX, but at least we come back and save him. And I really liked how Ico's Moogle, Mog, was secretly the summoned Maduin watching over Ico. That was a pretty epic reveal. Let me know some of your favourite Final Fantasy IX moments in the comments. We're coming to the end of things, and I just want to say, even though this was designed as a love letter to Final Fantasy, Number 9 is very much its own Final Fantasy, with one of the best worlds. It's double-edged with charming fantasy magical elements, but at the same time this world can be brutal, dark, and horrific. The Final Fantasy series always revisits the world and races of Evilus from Final Fantasy Tactics, through Vagrant Story, Final Fantasy 12, and even 14. But I really want us to revisit Nang's world of Gaia. I personally think it's a much more interesting world, from the magical city of Alexandria, Bermesia and its eternal reign, the night city of Trino, the tragic Black Mage village. I want to revisit this often overlooked world. But this Final Fantasy's strongest element is definitely its characters and the developments with them. I think Vivi and Zidane are the best, but they're all so well written. They're all believable, realistic characters, especially for a PlayStation 1 game. Well, maybe we could have had a few more moments with Amarant, but overall great. It doesn't take many risks, 9 just doubles down on what Final Fantasy does best. Characters, stories, worlds. This game is so uplifting and heartbreaking at the same time, it's fantastic. If you haven't played or finished the Menang, get out there and play it now. I'd recommend checking out the Maguri mod if you're playing on PC. Peace for now.